Well, you look about 30, but mind you, wartime might do that to you.
It was tough business, you know.
Where were you during the war, Daddy?
You are rotten.
Come on, I want it. I know, come on.
You've got it, come on. I'm not going to talk about it, Mike.
Okay. Well, all right. Okay, I'll tell you what then interests me about this. You would tell us stories, because we'd ask, you know, what did you do? What have you done? It came out that you were in the Fleet Air Arm, and you were an observer.
Well, this is where the observer would be, which I would have been. That's the observer's position. And you can see there's a wire at the bottom there, which you could attach to yourself in case you went inverted and you wouldn't get thrown out of the aircraft. And we have instruments here, which he could see. And he would communicate with the pilot, who is in a separate cockpit, purely and simply through a Gosport tube, which was kind of tube that you'd say, hello there, and you'd listen. There was no electronics involved.
We'd say, well, what do you do? He said, well, sort of observe. Right, right. But you were in charge. Yeah. So it was a very important role, in fact, even above the pilot, which kind of amazed us. But years later, I thought, that's the producer.
Yes, it is.
It's the same job. Oh, I remember that, in Paris.
There's Brian.
I was just talking about that.
Chamber pot on his head.
Yeah.
Judy's there.
Uh-huh.
And if you remember, and it was very naughty.
It was all the food was in phallic or...
Yeah, the rolls were a particular shape.
It was a hoot. It was great, you know. And we'd never seen anything like that. I suspect Brian might have.
Yes, well, he chose it, all right.
Yeah, that's what I mean, yeah.
But they also got Judy standing on the table, putting a garter around her leg. Remember that?
Yeah. She didn't need much persuading.
We don't really want to hang out with him. It's Mrs. Martin we all love. The great Judy, who we thought when we started was the queen. She was so posh. Oh, hello. He was a bit posh, but she was over the top.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to just now have a few words from our recording manager.
Mr. George Martin.
George Madison Martin. Here he is. George Madison. Come here, George. Say a few swinging new fab words for the Christmas market.
It's been a switched on year for George too, fab Beatle people, and we all hope you appreciate it. Here he is.
I'll edit it out.
He won't talk, Beatle people. He won't.
Gun independent. One, two, three, should all acquaintance be forgot and never more to run.
Where on earth did that come from?
A load of lunatics, if you ask me. That's the Beatles fan club record. It's got to be.
Oh.
Remember the fan club record?
Right, well done you.
Every year, we'd take 10 minutes of the session time
and
do nonsense like this.
Well, I'm blessed. I'd quite forgotten about that.
But we couldn't get you to speak. So professional. It was funny, actually. You know that time, if you remember, we all came in rose-coloured or funny-coloured specs. And where I was living, there was a little optician round the corner. And I sort of popped in. So I said, do you do different coloured lenses and everything? He said, yeah, I'd do anything. So I ordered up, like, half a dozen different colours, you know, rose, green, blue, and took them to the session.
That was to give you a bit of atmosphere in the studio. I remember all of you saying, this is a sterile place. It's just white walls and bloody awful. Can't you do something to liven it up?
Mm.
And so they put in three fluorescent stands with red, blue and white.
No, it's red and green.
Was it green?
I know, because I've got them. Right. They're in my studio. Yeah. Fluorescent bulb.
That was to give you inspiration.
And boy, did it ever. We grooved after that.
Paul was always much more interested in music per se, whereas John was always more interested in words per se. And I think this relationship benefited from the ping-pong of those things. I mean, I think Paul always wanted to be able to write lyrics like John could do, and John really envied Paul's gift for melody. John once said to me, let's face it, George, I don't expect to walk into a bar in Spain and hear people whistling I'm the Walrus. There's you doing your mixing.
There's me producing all the Beatle records, as I did. Not really.
Wry smile on his face.
Just kidding. Wry smile as he sees me do it completely wrong. He said, I'll leave him. No. He's screwing it up. I'll leave him. But this is interesting because in the very first sessions, I always say we came in the tradesman's entrance, if you'd remember. We didn't come in through the control room.
That's right.
But by this time, we'd got in control room, mate.
Well, I know how to
We're
do
getting
it.
Up there. Yeah. Never mind taking over the asylum. Look at us. Whoa. Working it.